Hi all, welcome to part two in our series on the exterior algebra of a linear space Vn. Last time we talked about characterizing the linear space Vn as a fiber bundle over a discrete topological space of basis vectors of Vn. So these basis vectors, ek, are the points of a topological space, and we're going to construct a topology out of these points. Visualize this as a fiber bundle over the base space of the points, the ek. Now, how do we get the topology? You may be wondering, why are we going to all this trouble to get the topology? Well, it's going to turn out to be quite useful. So let's go ahead and construct a discrete topology. I'm going to call it tau n on the points ek. And we're going to do this by enumerating the elements of the topology. So tau n is going to be shown to consist of 2 to the n elements. These are open sets. It is going to consist of the set B, the basis points, the empty set, and all possible distinct unions and intersections of the n points ek. So how many distinct subsets can we construct from the set of points ek? So we're going to do some counting here. Well, the sets of that are the elements of tau n are sets having some cardinality, call it p, where p ranges from 0, cardinality of the empty set is 0, to n, where you have the complete set of all the basis vectors. So we're going to construct these subsets of the basis by taking n things p at a time. So we're talking about combinations of basis vectors. So the number of elements that you get for tau n having a particular cardinality p is given by the number of combinations of n things taken p at a time, the binomial coefficient. Everybody knows this. Okay, so now we have a handle on how many sets there are in the topology tau n. Let's check this out for a case. I think it helps to make this table. So we're going to look at the linear space V4 with the basis B of 4 basis vectors. So let's look at the combinations that we can construct from these 4 elements. So taking 0 at a time, you get the empty set. 1 at a time, you get the individual basis vectors. 2 at a time, you get these 6 distinct pairs of basis vectors. 3 at a time over here, there are 4 distinct subsets. And then finally, there's only 1 instance of the entire set of basis vectors over here. Okay, so let's total this up. We can calculate the binomial coefficient, np, and check that it agrees. There's 1 element for p equals 0, 4 elements for 1, and so on. 6, 4, 1, which sums to 16, and that's 2 to the 4th. Okay, so it's nice to look at this all together, I think. Look what we have here. Our topology, tau 4, is this entire collection of these subsets. So the topology tau 4 consists of 16 elements, 2 to the 4th. Oops, I'm zeroing out my... Okay. Well, that was pretty easy. We have this topology. Now, look what we have here. If we take wedge products of these sets, you know, since each of the subsets in this table consists of distinct basis vectors, EK, they have non-vanishing wedge products. And there's a special case here where you have to deal with the empty set. It's always causing trouble, isn't it? Not really, but the wedge product of the empty set is going to be equal to the number 1. So it's the basis of the one-dimensional space of real numbers. And this is sort of analogous, so you can think of this as, well, we're choosing elements of the basis, and if we choose none of them, you still are kind of left with the real numbers because the linear space consists of the vectors, the basis vectors, and the real numbers. So it's a little bit like the same argument that 0 to the 0th power is equal to 1. So anyway, we can take that as just a definition that the exterior power of the set, the empty set, is equal to 1. Okay. So that went pretty easy to get the topology. Now let's see what we can do about getting the exterior power space wedge V4. So we need to construct the wedge product, and we're going to call these 16 wedge products that you get from the topology WK, where K equals 1 through 16, and we're going to construct this wedge product for each element of tau 4. So you have sets of distinct vectors, and we're ordering them by the index. And so, for instance, W13, if you take them in order, is the wedge product E1, wedge E2, wedge E4. W1 is going to be the wedge product of the empty set. That's equal to 1. W2, the wedge product of E1 is E1, and so on. Altogether, we're going to end up with 16 of these W basis vectors. So we can construct vectors of the form alpha k times w summed from k equals 1 to 16, where alpha k, a point in R16. So these are 16 real numbers. The components of the vector A in the 16-dimensional linear space wedge V4. So we have explicitly constructed all of the vectors in this space. They obey the rules. Summation and scalar multiplication follow through just the way they did for V4 in the first place. Now there's a question that needs to be discussed. The WKs do span this space, but we haven't really shown yet that they are, we haven't proved yet that they are linearly independent. We know that the individual WKs here are non-vanishing, but we don't know that they are a linearly independent set of basis vectors. Okay, so now that was pretty easy. We have the linear space wedge V4, the exterior power space of V4. What do we have to do to get the exterior algebra? We're charging ahead here, moving pretty fast. So we have the exterior product space here. To get the exterior algebra of this space, we must show that A wedge B is equal to C, which is an element of the exterior power space for all A and B in the space. We have to show that the wedge product of any two vectors in this space gives you another vector in the space. Now, we first observe that it's sufficient to show this for the vectors that span the space, the wk. I'm going to call this the basis because it's pretty easy to prove that these are basis vectors, and we'll do that a little bit later. So we'll call this the wk basis of the exterior power space of V4. So one way you could do this is to construct a multiplication table for all these wedge products. You know, this is not an impossible thing to do. Each of these, we have 16 vectors, and so you have 16 by 16 products. But we can shortcut this. We observe that each vector in the basis, each WK, is a p-order product of the basis vectors of Vn. So therefore, we can add a label to each basis vector that gives the order of the product. And so products can be of order 0, 1 through n. Of order n would be the single element that's just the product of all of the basis vectors ei. So we can write this as wk with a p index on here. And P is telling you the order of the basis vector in the exterior power linear space. Okay, so we can start doing some algebra on this index. Every W in the basis, WK, that goes from 1 to 2n has a value of P that's equal to 0 to n. We can write down a couple of formulas here. If you have WKP wedge WIQ, that's equal to 0 if P plus Q is greater than N. And that's obvious because each of these vectors here consists of a product of basis vectors EK. And if you have a wedge product that has more than N basis vectors in it, then some of those must be equal. And so any wedge product that has two equal vectors in it somewhere must be zero. So we have this formula right here. It means that the order of the products cannot increase indefinitely. So that's comforting. That's going to indicate that this wedge may be closed. What if P plus Q is less than or equal to N? Well, then we can write out this product of two compound products. We'll call this first one with P basis vectors in it, E alpha, wedge E beta, and so on, wedge E gamma, P distinct basis vectors of Vn. And here's Q, Q distinct basis vectors, E mu, E nu, E sigma. Now this product has to be equal to either 0 if there are two or more of these factors that are equal, that gives you the 0 vector, or if there are no pairs of equal vectors in the compound product, then this product is an order P plus Q vector, and that must be an element of the W's, and it may be plus or minus W. So this product here is giving you back one of the basis vectors, WK, with a plus or minus sign, or it might give you a zero. Okay, let's think about what that means. Products of the WKs then are either zero or plus or minus one of the WJs, and hence the wedge product of two basis vectors is closed in the space wedge Vn. And because the product of basis vectors is closed, it implies that the product of any two vectors in the exterior power space of Vn is another vector in the exterior power space. So this argument here establishes the exterior algebra of the exterior product space wedge Vn. Okay, we'll stop here. There's more to talk about, and we'll do that in the next part. in this series. We moved along pretty fast here. We left a few chores to do. We have to pick up a few threads along the way, and we'll do that next time. But you've pretty much seen how the exterior algebra of a linear space is constructed. I hope you enjoyed this quick introduction. Please leave any questions or comments on YouTube.